Morning. I want to welcome everyone that's joining us here today, but also that's streaming. Welcome. Me and my brother now that just sing, we have and me preaching. So I guess we have a gathering of the old and the older. So thank goodness that God's grace is sufficient in it, brother. And yeah, there's a lot of things going on in today in the world, and it's a very unusual, strange time. Before I get in the message today, I'm not sure how far we'll get on this, but we'll start anyway. I want to read the scripture starting in 2 Timothy chapter 3. I'm going to be reading verses 1 through 7. So those would like, if you'd like to stand for the reading of the word. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. For of this sort are they which crept into houses and led captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. You may be seated. The first verse says, know this also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. The title of the message this morning is, we are living in perilous times.
Amen. See,
not the last days are coming, we're living in them now.
They are here. Amen.
And I've shared some on the last days before here and some signs. And I'm kind of going back to where I've been before. But I think where so many people miss it, about the last days, and we hear a lot about that, is we focus on things happening in government, things happening in nature, but we very seldom talk about what would be happening among people professing Christ. The people that have a form of godliness, but they deny the power of it.
Amen.
Now, as Pentecostal, we say, well, they're denying the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But God's power in my life is released through His Lordship.
Amen.
He's Lord.
Yeah.
We just had an election recently, but the Lord doesn't run for re-election.
Amen.
There
you go. He's it from the beginning. He's it now. And He'll be it in the millennial period, and He'll be it in eternity.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
So, we're not going to get good enough when we get to eternity. We can now run against Him and maybe take His place. He is Lord.
Yes, He is.
And it's not enough to say, Lord, Lord. We've done these things in Your name. Matthew 7 talks about that. And the Lord didn't even know them.
Right.
It's those who bow the knee and recognize He is the Lord. He bought us with a price. He gave His life for us. He not only created us for Himself, but when we were sold into sin, He bought us back. So He has every right to be Lord. No, that He's good at it. But for Him to really be Lord and direct my life, I've got to have a relationship with Him.
Oh, yes.
If He's going to direct every step of my life, like Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, then I got to be able to communicate with Him.
Amen. True.
And he should be directing my steps. But we don't hear too much taught about that in churches as a whole around the world. Because the ministry that I have, I travel all over the world. We go to 6 different continents. We go to 120, 130 different nations around the world. It's not taught the fundamentals. It's taught he's Lord, but the fundamentals of how to actually do it and to abide in his presence so we can enjoy more of the inheritance we have, not too much of the foundations of that are taught. So much of it ends up being theory, or we say things that are truth, but we don't have fruit in our life proving that's true. And so this is part of what's happening in the last days. And this corruption of the church didn't just start in our generation. It started while the first apostles were still alive. Didn't even get out of the apostolic age. Paul was dealing with that all the time. So I don't want to get sidetracked. I just want you to understand Satan started getting inroads into and corrupting doctrines and teachings even when Paul was still preaching. And he's been doing it for 2,000 years, so he's got 2,000 years of practice of doing that. And the evidence that we see says he's getting better at it all the time. So we've had periods in that 2,000 years when things become very dark. Things are really going the wrong way. And somewhere a spark would hit. God would pick maybe one man or one woman that humbled themselves before him and cried out to him, and he poured his spirit on that one person. And they rose up and set fire to everything around. In our country, Charles Finney was one of those people. One man. That just turned our country upside down and turned it from going completely the wrong direction. We were about to lose it before we even hardly got started. And God raised up the one man. He had a huge team. He had one man working with him, an intercessor. Preacher and the intercessor. That's it. That was his team. And yet God used him in such a powerful way. We need some finish today. He doesn't need the multitudes. He never has used the multitudes. He's always found a person or a small group that would just simply trust him and obey him. That's one of my favorite songs, Trust and Obey. Why? Because there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. So it's not an option. If you want to be happy in Jesus, then you got to trust him. And if you trust him, you will obey him. It's not enough to say, Lord, I trust you. But you don't ask him anything. You don't come before him to find out, then what does he want to tell you to do? We've got to make that happen. So we see this, the church, getting weaker and weaker. And Satan has snuck in doctrines. He's watered down things. He brought things that are sounds good, true. He could even use scriptures for them. But the conclusions they would come to would not be the truth. It'd be a lie. So he snuck those in. And many of the organizations around the world that started hundreds of years ago started through one person that really did obey the Lord, trust the Lord, and obey the Lord. And they were anointed, and God used them in a powerful way. So they gathered up his sermon notes. But you realize that man did not know everything about every subject. No one does. But they took what he did know. But you can't start an organization without a doctrine. So there's a lot of holes. So then they started filling them in with theories and things. And this group over here, we had some of the same scripture, but some of the other things a little different. So we separated. And Satan would give you the scripture if you didn't know it. How can two walk together except you agree? Well, we don't agree, bro, so I guess we just have to separate. So we use this name, you use that name. And Satan's been playing that game until today, in the last days, generally now, I'm not, obviously the exception to every rule, but generally, this is describing where the church or those confessing Christ or pretending to be godly are. We know that one of the signs in the last days that the love of God would wax cold. But what is the love of God? What does it mean to love God? John 14:15, Jesus said, "If you love me, keep my commandments." You read on through verse 23 of that. Again, he who has my word and keeps it, he it is that really loves me. And I'll love him and my Father will love him. So Jesus does not separate loving him from obeying him. But we say, "I love you," but we don't do it. But how many homes, how many marriages are weak? Because they just tell each other they love them, but they don't bring any works meet proving they love them. You need some works done with it. And with Jesus, he's trying to say you love him. There's nothing wrong with that. But then when he speaks to you, you should seek him as an opportunity to show your love to him. And when he speaks to us, then I obey what he speaks to me, but I do it for only one reason. Not because I may get something out of it or this may happen. I do it for one simple reason. That's my opportunity to show him that I love him. It doesn't bother me if it's a harder commandment, because to me, that means it's going to take more trust and love to obey that. So I'm going to express more love to him. Now, this is a whole different subject, but it's important.
Yeah.
Because I also understand the scripture, whatever you sow, you're going to reap.
True.
And I didn't know that back when I started, but when I was sowing what little bit of agape love I had in me, that I was able to obey God, I sowed that in, but I also reaped the same thing back.
Amen.
Except he always gave me more. So I didn't understand what was going on back then, but I could see the love of God growing in me. And then that moved over to my wife, and she saw the difference. And she went, "What in the world is going on with you?" I said, "I don't know. I'm just working on something. Just pray for me." I was having a big time, but I couldn't explain to you why I was or what was causing it. Yeah. So every time I try to share with somebody, then they won't. "Well, where's that at in the scripture? Where's that?" I had no idea at that time. So I just stuck with me and the Lord and just worked on doing what he was saying. But this is degenerated. And the reason this has is because we have not maintained solid scriptural foundations to build on. Anytime you're dealing with anything, you start having problems. The building, you go up higher and you start having cracks in the wall, whatever. First thing you do, realize something's wrong in the foundation. There's inferior materials there. We didn't dig it deep enough. We didn't put enough reinforcement in it. It always goes back to the foundation. Ball players, no matter how much many millions of dollars they're being paid, they didn't perform good on Sunday or Saturday. Monday, the coach got them watching film, and he showed them all the little mistakes they made, and guess what those mistakes were? Not the advanced thing that they can do they're getting paid millions for. It was things that's having to do when they're in elementary school. Or when they was in high school, the fundamentals the coaches taught them then, that they didn't do it in that place. So it was in the wrong place at the wrong time. So it's the same way scripturally. We keep wanting to go and try to fix what is already corrupted. And God is saying, go back to the beginning. Our ministry focuses on it wherever I go in the world. And because I can tell you where the real problem with the foundation is. It's the cornerstone. Jesus is the cornerstone. Now, you could say he's the cornerstone, but that don't mean you really believe he is from your heart. Because the cornerstone is where they took the measure of everything from the rest of the foundation, and the building came off of that cornerstone. So it originated everything. Well, Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the architect. So it starts with Him. So whatever I do, it starts with Him. Lord, what do you want me to do now? And the next step or the next hole dug or whatever put it, it's what He told me to do. He decides. If I've already gone till I've already got everything, part of it good and part of it bad, I still go back to the cornerstone and set that right, then let Him tear down whatever needs to be tore down or adjust whatever needs to be adjusted. It don't mean everything has to be thrown away, because He can go back and fix things, unlike we couldn't do that in the natural realm.
True.
He can go back and leave that one good one hanging there until He gets everything supposed to go around it, up to it, and it's ready to go. But He's not going to put anything on top of it until He gets what's supposed to be under it. So we all have a lot of good things, but for it to be systematically done so that we've got a solid foundation that will stand in perilous times. Remember, that's the title of the message. In the last day, there'll be perilous times coming. And the title is, we are living in the perilous time. I shared on this before, on this particular scripture here at this church. But since then, we've had some things happening around the world that hadn't happened then. This coronavirus that hit last year has completely changed the entire world. And it really changed the United States of America. I was thinking about World War II. There was something like 60-something nations lost people in that war. And the United States, we lost 400-something thousand in the 5 years of World War II. That was a terrible war. But do you realize in less than a year, we've already passed that threshold? And we've lost more of the coronavirus than we lost in all of World War II. The whole 5 years of World War II. That's mine. But nobody's come taking our land from us. See, that's the fear of them. They're going to come and rule our land, and we're fighting and willing to die to preserve our land. With the coronavirus, we've lost more people, and we're losing our land. Do you realize how dramatically the attitude in our land towards non-Christian thinking has amplified in this 1 year of this pandemic? When do you think spiritually and as a church, our nation as a whole started kind of going further the wrong direction, speeding up? Most of it happened after World War II. But it was really kind of slow. And we didn't pay much attention to it. Okay, then we was comfortable, we accepted that. Then Satan brings a little something else around. We accept that, then he brings something else to corrupt just a little bit more. And we see that in organizations that World War II, or even when I was a child, that they believe it is part of their doctrines now, and they allow in their organizations, that have been completely thrown out of the same organization 50 years ago.
Oh, yeah.
It'd been an abomination. They wouldn't believe you could even be a Christian and believe that. And now they not only can you go to church there, you could be the pastor there and have that. That's what he's talking about here, these conditions. I think we've been spoiled because God's given us so much grace. There's never been a nation like the United States or a constitution like our constitution that is built on the Judeo-Christian foundations. But everything now is aimed at destroying that. Just the opposite. One of the signs of the last days is that they start saying that which is right is wrong and that which is wrong is right. It'd been hard to believe when I was younger that anybody would put up with what people say now is right. And the ones that actually are right, they not only say you're wrong, but they attack you like you're a complete threat to the nation. Not just you're wrong, we disagree, so we'll agree to disagree. No, they want to destroy you. And these are leaders. What's scary is we have a small percentage of people that clearly Satan is using that's dictating and controlling our whole nation. And we've got millions and millions of Christians in our nation that aren't saying anything. Some of them won't even vote against it. And they're professing to be godly. They agree with it. And they go to church. That's pretty scary. Yes. Where did all this start? How did we so long ago start getting off on the church growing up? Because when the fivefold ministry was given in Ephesians 4:11, they was given to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. They would grow up and not be tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine, but grow up to the fullness of the measure of the stature of Christ. And we end up in Christ's body. He is the head. Everyone in the body, where they belong in the body, and having things effectually worked in you, so you actually are sharing something with somebody that is effectual, and they're sharing something effectual with you. Then we all grow in love. That's the church. Amen. That's a minister's responsibility to bring the church to that place. Well, here's another sign of the last days in chapter 4. Paul was fixing to leave, and he's turning things over to Timothy. And 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. I charge you therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at the appearing of his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. But after their own lusts, shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned into fables. Well, that's clearly being fulfilled now. Because if the preacher now did those three things that it said to do, they'd be preaching to the benches in most places. They would. They'd just go down the road where someone's not going to mess with them. I didn't come to church for you to make me uncomfortable. I come to you to tell me I'm okay. And I can find scriptures that make you feel good. It's no problem. I mean, all kinds of churches are preaching scripture, but it's not a word in season. And they're not serving God. They're not hearing God. God isn't speaking through them to his people. They're speaking what some other voice is giving them, and it isn't God. It's a way that seems right, but it's leading to destruction. But I want to encourage you, those that love the Lord and you're faithful, this is an exciting time. Now, you may not be thinking, ha ha, I really like this. Because it doesn't seem very exciting. But a lot of things are going on. Let's turn to Luke chapter 21. Pages are thin on something, doing something you're not supposed to be doing. I'm licking my fingers. Luke 21, I'm going to start reading verses 25 through 28. And it's talking about the last days and things that's going to be happening right before Jesus comes back. And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and upon the earth, then distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things that are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. I went one verse beyond that. No, excuse me, I won't go on 28. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draws nigh.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. You're one of the sad parts about this pandemic and those that are in charge and those that I believe Satan is using have been isolating people to extremes out of fear of what's coming on and creating greater problems. Children can't go to school, creating greater problems than what they're trying to solve. And they're not looking to that too much, but just now starting to see the amount of people that have been isolated during this pandemic, that have lost their jobs, lost their businesses, stuck in home with children 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Amen.
So you got all kind of things, pressure on people that they never had before. And they had foundations, they can handle life as it normally was. But as this extra weight and pressure comes, their foundations are given away. And people are committing suicide.
Yes,
there are abuse of children in homes. There are abuse of wives in the home. There's all kind of violence going on. People's anger is just under a rage. You see some of these people, one little word, least little thing said, and they go into rage like you'd shot their best friend or their child or something. I mean, just so extreme, it's ridiculous. It burned half the city down. It's because they didn't like what something happened. And none of that's going to fix anything. It's just lashing out. And it just creates more terror.
Makes it worse.
We Christians are not immune to that. Because that same pressure that's coming on everyone around the world, it's coming on Christians as well. So how do you react to that? I want to look at a couple of words here. It was talking about there'd be distress of nations with perplexity. That word perplexity in Webster means embarrassment of mind, disturbance from doubt, confusion, difficulty, or anxiety. Is that not what's going on now? Men's hearts failing them, more heart attacks going up. The distress, again, it's anxiety, anguish. How are you dealing with that? Because no matter how negative something seems, there's a positive side to it. Maybe you just got a small candle, and with all the bright lights around, nobody notices your little candle. But those big bright lights start going out, and it's getting darker and darker, all of a sudden, you're the center of attention, your little candle. Many of you still got jobs. When you go to work, all the confidence everybody has and all the brightness that they're glowing out there, and they can handle anything, what they can do is going out. But when they see you, that you're not disturbed by that. You're not anxious. You've got peace. God's peace. And you got joy. And you're not worrying about nothing. Everybody's looking at you. Because you're different. But if they see you reacting just like they do, then what is the difference? One very important thing about our faith, the scripture says, the trying of our faith is much more precious than gold. This period of time for the last year has been a real trying of our faith. And I'm not so sure it's going to get much better. So I don't have any rosy forecast, but 2021 is going to be wonderful. In 19, I thought 20 was going to be good. We're looking pretty good there here. Things are coming in our country, is going and blowing. Even up to about March, it's still looking very good. Then everything came unglued. In 2 Timothy 1:7, says, "For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind." So the fear that any Christian is experiencing did not come from God. The fear, any of us from this pandemic is very, Satan is the author behind that. So God didn't give us his spirit of fear. So my testimony should be, I shouldn't have any fear. If my faith believes what God said, then why should I have fear? One of the last greatest things we went through as a nation, personally, was back in the Depression, the Great Depression. And then people lost everything. And they're fearful that they're even going to be able to feed their families, even just survive. And with all that fear on them, Franklin Delano Roosevelt was elected president. And in 1933, his first inaugural address, he made this statement: "The only thing we have to fear is fear itself." Now we're back in maybe not that bad a situation, but it's coming close to it. It was coming towards it. It is in a different, because I'm not sure. I didn't look up any stats on it. Yes, it was hard during the Depression, but how many people died during the Great Depression from the Great Depression? I doubt it's what has died from this virus. Anywhere close. Again, we've lost more than we lost in all of World War II. So on top of that, people lost their jobs. They struggled to feed their families. They spent their life building businesses and it's gone. Just because someone said, "Close your doors, you can't be open." You understand? One person, a governor or something, "You cannot open these," and your life's worth gone. People can't handle that in the natural. So we're right in the middle of this. You're very blessed if you didn't lose your job or your business. You're very fortunate. But what if you did? Should you be fearful? Should I believe my family is going to starve? Well, the script says you've never seen the righteous forsaken or children begging buried. Is God really our source? Or are we our source? I've got this, I've got this, I've got this savings, I've got this investment, I've got this job. I can take care of my family. Then all of a sudden, you can't take care of your family. That'll bring a testing where your faith is. Was it in you and your ability? Or was it in God? Nothing wrong with having all these things. But if you're blessed, guess where the blessing came from? Give honor where honor is due. Give credit where credit is due. So this is a troubling time. In Philippians, chapter 4, I'm going to read verses 6 through 8. It says, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God which passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. And finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Now that word, when it says be careful for nothing, it's talking about being anxious for nothing. Or in terminology we put today, don't worry about nothing. Now that's not a suggestion, that's a commandment. So you realize worrying is sin? Disobeying God is sin, folks. But I've got a reason to worry. No, you don't. The lost have a reason to worry. But you don't have a reason to worry because you serve a living God that loves you more than anybody on this planet could ever love you. And he said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. He will be there. If you believe, he will be there. But as your faith is, so be it unto you, is another scripture. If you don't believe you're going to make it, guess what? You're not going to make it. If you believe you're going to lose your house, guess what? You're probably going to lose your house. Because you're releasing your faith into Satan to make what you're believing come true. The authority you have and the power you have, you're releasing it into the enemy to bring that to you. Your greatest fears will come on you.
Yes, it will.
They come on you when you fear to the point that you release your faith that that's going to happen. And then it comes about, then we get offended at God because he let it happen. We're the ones that let it happen. When I first started walking with the Lord, and I was working a pretty dangerous job at that time, I was reading the Bible not with my reason and understanding, but believing only the Holy Spirit could reveal the truth to you. So I wasn't trying to understand it. I just read it and waiting on the Holy Spirit to quicken me. I didn't know what grade I was in. I didn't know what book I would be reading today, like in school. I'm waiting on the teacher. So I'm just reading this and asking the Holy Spirit, the teacher, if I run across the scripture, something you want to show me now, then quicken it to me. Then he amplified, you know, expound on it, and I'll do whatever you tell me to do. Just quit doing something or start doing something. Well, that's one case that happened on this when I read this. Because we're going through some tough times at that time. Because sure enough, I've been married 55 years. And that couple years in, when I was really going through some deep training with the Lord, if I pick two of the most economically devastating 2 years of our entire 55 years, it was those 2 years. But if I picked which 2 years are absolutely the most prosperous spiritually, it had been the same 2 years. And my wife can tell you, once I got a hold of this, I didn't worry about nothing. But seeing something and even agreeing that that's right doesn't change it if you don't believe it in your heart and do it. It's not enough to believe it with your mind. It's what you believe in your heart that rules you. The devils believe that Jesus is the Son of God. They're not saved. So getting it from the head down to the heart is the little difficult part. That's where the faith comes in.
Yes, amen.
I have to first be convinced that it's the truth. Then I have a choice. Am I going to believe that or not? Because if I choose to believe it, that means I've committed myself to do it. Because James 1:22 said, be doers of the word, not hearers of the law only, deceiving yourself. So if you sit in church and you just hear the pastor Sunday after Sunday preach something and you nod your head and say, yeah, that's right, I agree with that. But you don't let it change you, you don't do anything, then you're actually deceiving your own self. Christians are doing, that's how we got in the state we're talking about in 2 Timothy there. Because even when they do hear truth, they don't do it. That's why we hired a preacher to do it. He's supposed to know it. Then when I get in trouble, I'll call him. No, he's supposed to be calling Jesus. If you're really trusting God with all your heart, you mean that means I won't ever get in trouble? No, you might get in more. You'll still have problems. The difference is the problems won't have you. And every time he allows you to get in a problem, he just gives me another opportunity to build a testimony of his grace, his love, and his mercy. I was a little nervous when I first started this. The Lord put me in some situation that I can see no way in the world how they're going to get out of this. But I chose, I'm trusting him. And if it all falls apart and it goes the way it looks like it's going to go, which means I won't be existing anymore, because it's those kind of situations, then at least the last thing I ever do, he knew I was trusting him. At least doing what I thought he said, whether that's wrong or not. I believed I was doing what he said. And I got in one of those earlier on that just looked ridiculous. But I was determined I was going to trust the Lord, but I'm battling these thoughts coming, so I'm trying to keep my trust in the Lord. And so I kind of sheepishly said to the Lord, I didn't want to be doubting, but I said, Lord, it's going to be interesting to see how you get out of this. And I'll never forget this. And the Lord said, son, is anything too hard for me? I said, no, Lord. He said, you stand back and see the salvation of the Lord your God. And within 2 or 3 days, and I've been waiting 3 months, within 2 or 3 days, boom, everything. He came in and took care of the whole situation. But I never even asked him that anymore. I'd always think, wow, the place I got in that looked more impossible, now that may sound crazy to you, but when he put me in places that looked more ridiculously impossible that you could get out of it, for some reason, that tickled my funny bone. That would seem funny to me. And I get excited because I'm going to get to see him really do something special. You understand? That I've never seen him to do. And nobody around me was encouraging me that it was going to happen. They said, you're crazy. You will get killed doing that. But that's part of my early training and early ministry when I was pioneering countries around the world, and especially those that were very dangerous. But that peace that passes all understanding, when he first showed that to me, I was in a dangerous situation. I won't get into all the details on that. I probably shared this anyway. But it appeared if I did what God said, I would be killed. That's kind of the situation I was in. But I would pray and I'd get the peace. But when I would see the problem I was going to have to face every night, and it was coming to a climax later on, as soon as I'd see the danger there, the peace would go away. And I'm trying to think of these things. I knew I need to be thinking on these things here. But all of a sudden, when the threat was there, I couldn't think of anything. I've just seen that. Well, that made me mad. So I went home, and I wrote down each one of these things here in verses 8. Whatever things are true, whatever things are honest. I took each one of those and made a heading. And I prayed through it. I thought about some either scripturally that God did under that category or he had done in my life. So I wrote down two or three things, each one of them. I had a legal piece of paper, folded it up, put it in my pocket. And I go to work, and this situation starts coming in, up, and I start feeling my peace shaking a little bit. I jerk that out, and I start focusing on one of those, and the peace would settle down. Then I got where then I just focused on the one that made all these things happen. So I didn't need to pull it out. You understand what I'm saying? I just kept my focus on him. This isn't my problem. That's his problem. My responsibility is to do whatever he tells me to do. And I'm to stand back and see the salvation of the Lord my God. And so my first learning of this in a test was within 2 weeks after I discovered the scripture. I literally faced a life and death situation that looked impossible. And when I finally was confronted with it, it was a gang of about 25 that had sworn to kill me. I'm there defenseless because I had a pistol then, I had a rifle, I had a shotgun, I had a billy club, I had all those things, little badge and hat. Yeah. But before I went and faced him, this encounter is going to happen. I told the Lord I was afraid I might shoot one of them. It's just out of reflex. And the Lord said, that's no problem. Take your pistol and lock it in the trunk of the car. You can't shoot somebody if you don't have one. So to make a long story short, he had me put all that in there. He said, you won't need that club either. So he stripped me down to my hat and my badge. And now it's time to go. So I went back behind this place, behind a dumpster and prayed again, made sure I got my peace. Because this is the time I had to actually confront them. And when I turned the corner and saw them where before, you know, the fear would hit. This time, fear didn't even approach me. See, as soon as I turned the corner, not only did I have the peace, but it was so overwhelming, it was just ridiculous. I mean, it's just unbelievable the amount of peace. It makes absolutely no sense. And I had joy. Because I was in such presence of God. The presence of God was so strong around me that I had joy. And I'm trying to look serious to confront these people. But I couldn't. I wanted to laugh. And it wasn't a ha-ha moment. And I'm trying to be serious. But I couldn't keep them grinning, which infuriated them even more. And I'm just standing there. I just said, what God told me to do. I'm standing there. And you're going to kill him, going to kill him. All the guys were just going nuts. And out of the blue, just like that. I don't know what they saw, but panic, fear came on them. And that leader slapped his hands, and they all ran, jumped on their Harley choppers and squalled the tires and roared out of there. And I'm just standing there grinning. Now, that's a short story of that. But do you think I had any problem that day on believing the peace of God would hold under pressure? I didn't start in the kiddie pool. I jumped off the bluff in deep water. First time. The only thing that allowed that to happen was I determined to trust him with all my heart. This is what he said. Didn't make any sense for me to do that under those circumstances, But I already had the witness of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit witnessed that he was saying that. And the only question is, am I going to trust him or not? And if it looked like what was going to happen, was I willing to die to obey what he said? That's what it came down to. Because for all purposes, it seemed like I would die. But I didn't. But if I had, it wouldn't have mattered. So, do you have that peace? Because the problem in first world countries like we are, most Christians have the peace of the world. Same peace that everybody else has got that's not a Christian that has peace as long as everything is peaceful. So we work hard to make sure we keep an environment that we flow in that is peaceful. In other words, our church, we want it to be peaceful. That means you don't bring any message that makes me uncomfortable. Because I lose my peace if I get convicted. You hear what I'm saying? And if you do that to me, me and my billfold will go down to the next church. And first thing you know, they can't pay the light bills. And it puts pressures on minister. And it's easy to think, well, I can't help them if they leave. So I'm going to have to do what's necessary to keep them here so that I can help them. See, then they compromise. That's how we got in this mess we're in. And the minister is not the one supposed to be doing the work of the ministry anyway. You're supposed to be doing it. His job is to equip you to do the work of the ministry. Amen. I know our pastor talks a lot about evangelizing, leading souls. Well, we're referred to the shepherd, Jesus being the shepherd. We're the sheep, and we have sheep, and we have lambs. Sheep has the lambs. So we want to have more lambs, right? We want more people born into the family. Amen. Then who normally produces a lamb, the shepherd or the sheep? It's a sheep's job to produce it. I give you even a harder one. When the sheep has a lamb, who's supposed to be feeding the lamb, the shepherd or the sheep? You should be discipling, and they should be following you as you're following the shepherd. As he's following the Lord. We'll change that whole simplicity. Or you've got to be in Christ to do that. To do that, he's got to be Lord. You've got to trust him with all your heart. So I think this is an exciting time. Because I think a lot of Christians have woken up and realized, I'm not where I thought I was. It's shown some flaws. And I think that's very healthy. I think it's very good if you process it properly. Don't get under any condemnation, but don't be afraid of conviction. Conviction is not a negative thing. It just means you're convinced of something. God's convinced you that you're not where you should be. So go to him and repent and ask him to show you why you're not where you're supposed to be. What do you want me to do next? And he'll correct that. I mean, now if you have faith in something, but your foundation is shallow, up to a certain point of pressure, you have no trouble trusting God. But you put another 100 pounds of pressure on it, that foundation breaks away and you won't trust him. Everybody has a limit somewhere. You understand what I'm saying? This is an opportunity to check your foundations. And if you find cracks in them or it just fell apart, go back to the cornerstone. That's where the problem's at. Just focus on the cornerstone. He'll focus on the rest of the stuff. Just seek him. You don't have to worry about what needs to be done next. He knows what needs to be done next. Just focus on the relationship. Focus on trusting him. Pure, let him purify your faith. Because everything we receive from God comes by faith. The just shall live by faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Okay. Well, I'm about out of time here. Very quick, Acts 1:8. He says, you shall be endued with power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses both in Jerusalem and Judea and in the uttermost parts of the earth. I'm trying to hurry on this right here. That witness, you're given the power to be witnesses. I want everyone to read that. You're given power to witness. And it takes a lot more power to be something than it does to say something. And I've shared this before. I'm just quickly throwing that out again. It's what you are that speaks much louder than what you say. People don't believe what we say, but they will look at what you are. And this is our time, those that are faithful, to shine. To be what God's called us to be on our jobs, in our homes, in our neighbors. That they can see you've got something they don't have. And they'll be curious, how come you're not upset about this? How come you're not angry about that? Why aren't you in a rage? Why aren't you worried about this? Then they ask so you get a chance to answer. Because they're wanting to know. You don't have to preach at it, because you can just share your testimony. Testimony is powerful. In Revelation, I think it was 8, it's talking about those who overcome Satan. They did it by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Your testimony is powerful if it matches up to what you are. A lot of people are testifying things that the Bible says, testifying things that Jesus says, but they don't see it in us. We're supposed to be a reflection of Him. We're the ones supposed to be proving to them that what we're saying actually works. That we're actually doing the word, not just hearing it. So I got several more scriptures. That'd be for 2 or 3 more sessions. I'm trying to be faithful. Pastor came in on me back there, so I got to behave and try to find a period here. But I just want to encourage you that with everything's going on, this is a great opportunity. I want you to think about it. Remember the old song said, everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die? Well, everybody wants Jesus to come back, but nobody wants to go through all things got to happen before He comes back. Do you think this pandemic might be one of them? You realize a whole lot of things are going to have to go wrong on this planet, folks, before Jesus comes back. I just touched on some of them. This is just one of them. Who had ever thought a year ago something could happen that is going to affect nearly every, I think there are only like 2 nations in the whole world that's not affected by this. They may be by now. When the whole World War II is on like 60-something nations out of 200. Boom, just like that. More lives lost? My goodness. It's just starting. Now we see things we felt so secure in our nation. But Christians don't feel secure anymore. Now we're afraid. What's going to happen to our nation? Because many people have faith in our nation that we're going to ride everything out if the rest of them is going to go through everything. Well, we not only got the pandemic and lost a lot of people, but everything's going south in a hurry. Away from the Judeo-Christian concept of our Constitution. Rapidly. Just in this time of the pandemic, even though they've been coming since World War II, it's progressed more in this last year than it has in the last 50 years. Boom, just like that. And Christians have retreated more and more and more and more until you let Satan take a handful of people and turn our nation upside down. We've got a lot to repent of. We've got a lot to answer for. But it doesn't matter what comes. If you're faithful, it doesn't affect you. He will take care of you. I minister all over the world, and I go to brothers and sisters in some of the absolute terrible situations and persecution they're under, and they have peace, and they have joy, and they love the Lord. And they'll go out witness, knowing more than likely they're going to get killed. And they don't even hesitate. And they aren't even comfortable. Now, they're in third world countries. Their living standards aren't comfortable. And God's allowed that. And they're not offended at God. We get offended if everything's not just perfect. So it's a time to grow up some more. It's time to grow up. But remember, where all this sin is abounding, grace is much more abound. God gives grace to the humble. He resists the proud. And that's what he's doing. But to the humble, he's going to give you grace. And his grace, as Paul said, is sufficient. He gives us overcoming grace. So we need to go back to the cornerstone and establish lordship, first love, and trust and obey. He'll take care of the rest. It doesn't matter what storms come. He either will calm the storm or he'll calm us and let the storm raise. It doesn't matter. So when this storm is raging, you still should have peace, and you should have joy, and you should have comfort. Amen. Let's pray. Father, just praising you. Thank you for this day, Lord. And Lord, we just thank you for your word. And Lord, I thank you that you bless us with ears to hear and eyes to see what you're saying by the Spirit. And Lord, everyone you've spoken to here and that's listening, ask this word would go deep in their spirit and that you would water it and you bring forth much fruit for your glory. And they would guard it jealously and not let Satan steal one seed. Lord, thank you for your grace and your mercy. And we pray, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Amen.